The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GameCon Radio or its affiliates.
Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We have an awesome show tonight lined up, and I'm going to bring the guests on first, and then we're going to do the crazy but news towards the end of the show, because one of our guests might have to leave early. He's got an appointment at 9 o'clock my time. Our guest tonight these people are part of television history. There's no other way to put around it, and I am over the moon to have them. I want to welcome everybody in the chat room, everyone listening on players and the magic world of internet and radio that I don't understand anything about, but welcome everybody, and thank you for listening in. Our shows are recorded, so I will be putting it up on a podcast so you guys can download the show and save it when it's done. I usually post it on Facebook and my site and everything. I want to let everybody know GameCon Radio has some awesome shows. So if you're just browsing the internet, you're looking for music to listen to or some really cool shows, please, by all means, check out www.gameconradio.com. We have classic music. And then Saturday night's one of my favorite shows. Dr. Lester has old time radio, and we're talking like the Shadow Knows and the Green Room and all kinds of, the old mystery shows where Vincent Price and all of them did all those mysteries, and Alfred Hitchcock, and they were wonderful. But we have so many very cool shows, and check out our schedule page on GameCon Radio. And if anybody's ever looking for me, they can find me at my site, and that's asylumsgate.com. And without further ado, I would like to welcome our guests tonight, Kathryn Leigh Scott, Lara Parker, and Jim Pierson. Welcome to my lair, guys.
Hi. How are you?
Very cool.
Hi, Mo. Good to talk to you again.
Yes, it was wonderful last week. I really enjoyed it. I love it when guests talk, because sometimes it's really tough to get a guest to talk, and I love it. And you were so easy to work with, and I know we're just going to have a good time tonight. You guys, Jim, you're a representative for Dan Curtis Productions, right?
I think Jim will probably be joining us in a couple of minutes,
yes, he is. Yeah. You of course, Kathryn, we're going to open up the lines for calls in about 20 minutes, okay? So everybody just hang off on the calls, because there's going to be rules. This is my lair, and I always have the rules. I'm the rule keeper, okay?
Okay.
That's the way it runs in my house. But Kathryn, you were with Dark Shadows from the first episode, and Dan Curtis is said to have had like a dream or something of a mystery, and that's how it started.
Yeah, I don't know if that was apocryphal or not, but he talked about it in many different ways. But I think he was staying at the home. He was just out of the Army, and he was staying at the home of an Army buddy of his, and it was up in New England. And at one time he told me that he in the middle of the night he saw this ghost of this woman, and then another time he talked about having had a dream about this girl on a train. So, which sounds very sexual, actually.
I think
the genesis of, you know, the whole Victoria Winters story.
And yeah. Also the whole idea of Jane, we used all the classics, and the whole idea of Jane Eyre, you know, the young governess going off to the house on the hill, and people she ran into saying, "Oh, don't go there. You don't know what kind of horrible things happen there." I mean, that too was a classic novel that I think Dan Curtis drew from, or at least the writers drew from, among many novels that we redid on Dark Shadows.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember, was The Innocents already released? Remember Deborah Carr, where she was governess?
Yeah, it was, and I subsequently did a 2-hour film with Dan Curtis in England, and I played Miss Jessup in that with Lynn Redgrave and a bunch of wonderful English actors, Meg Jenkins and so on, doing that. By the way, Mo, if I could just jump in with Art Wallace was really the creator of Dark Shadows, and he wrote what is called a Bible, and it really was, as Lara says, very much a Jane Eyre sort of a story about a governess going to a remote place and not quite knowing why she had been summoned. So that was certainly in there, but it's really interesting. I published a copy of Art Wallace's Shadows on the Wall, which was the original name for the show, and it's really interesting because it covers only about the first 4 months of the show. And once Jonathan Frid came on as Barnabas, and even before that, Dan had already diverged. It was Art Wallace who wrote the first couple of scripts that we did when the show started.
Okay, I just want to, we really do want to extend our prayers for Marie Wallace, who was supposed to be here tonight, but her brother took ill yesterday morning, and it's sounding like it's very serious. And so I really, really hope that God will send angels and that everything will be okay for her, because, family is everything. It is for me, anyway. And our prayers are with her and her beloved right now, so God bless her. Her husband, I believe, was Art Wallace.
Marie?
No. Well, hi.
No.
You know,
hi.
You know what? Hi, it's Jim Pierson. Sorry for my disconnect here. And I spoke to Marie Wallace today, and she sent her regrets. But yeah, her brother is not well, and she just isn't able to join us tonight. But Marie Wallace is actually not related to Art Wallace. Art was a writer, going back to, the golden days of television, live television. And he had written a Goodyear Playhouse in 1957, a Goodyear Theater called The House. And he used part of that, premise as the template for the framework of the original Dark Shadows story about a reclusive widow, you know, in this mansion up on the hill with a teenage daughter, and then a seafaring kind of a crooked guy who came back to blackmail her, and some of the things that were integrated in the Dark Shadows. Mm-hmm. Once Dan Curtis came up with adapting the whole gothic formula for daytime television with Jane Eyre and then that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Laura, you got in this after Jonathan Frid was brought in, right?
Yes, he was the vampire, and the show took off. And the demographic of stay-at-home housewives fell in love with his character. Instead of playing the vampire like a monster or some crude, slathering bloodsucker, he chose to play him racked with guilt over his thirst for blood, and vulnerable and conflicted and reluctant. And here's this 18th elegant, sophisticated man wandering around Collinwood and being desperate over the fact that he has to go out of And what happened is that housewives fell in love with him, and this mail started pouring in, and housewives would send pictures of themselves, of their neck and other parts of their bodies, and say, you know, saying, please bite me, please bite me. And so he became so popular, and the show began to do so well, that they decided to go back in time to his beginnings and tell the story of how he became a vampire. And that's when my character was introduced.
I love that part where you did the, the first tryout, whatever they call audition. And he kind of leaned over and says, you do realize you're a witch, right?
That's right. I auditioned with him, and he whispered to me, the part is that of a witch. And so I stopped looking innocent and started looking mean and stared into the camera with a vicious look. And that was, I guess, how...
It's an amazing storyline. Which has, I've got to tell you, I went to Disney World, okay, and they have the pop culture. And when you can look in the little picture frames they have there and see a picture from Dark Shadows in Disney World in one of the pop culture windows, you know, in the lobby.
I didn't know that.
And I'm kind of like, you know, it's you see George Reeves, you see the guy that we both love, Kathryn, the Silver Bullet, the Lone Ranger.
Lone Ranger, yeah.
Yeah, and all these different characters, and that, I mean, it literally has become history, and it was actually history before Jim got involved with it, right, Jim?
Correct.
Yeah. You, how did you get involved with Dan Curtis Productions?
Well, when I got out of school, I majored in radio, TV, film, and I met Dan Curtis through his longtime composer, music composer, Robert Colbert, who worked with Dan on everything from Dark Shadows to The Winds of War, War and Remembrance, and all these great films and TV projects in between. And Dan was starting up to do a new series of Dark Shadows prime time, and so that was in 1990. And then I started doing marketing and promotion as well as production work, and it just became a full time, you know, occupation. And still involved with his estate. He left two daughters. His wife passed away the same month he did 6 years ago. And so it's been a real transitional time. But he always knew that Dark Shadows would live on. He always kind of, you know, kidded about it. And he enjoyed, you know, all the infamy the show brought. I mean, he was proud that it you know, lasted. And so many people enjoyed it.
Yeah. He obviously knew that this could go further and further. I mean, it's a perfect story to be updated. It can go, because let's face it, the vampire can still be from 1700s, and you can go right on through history with this. Kathryn, did you at any time think to yourself, what the heck did I get myself into?
No, never. This is my very first job out of school. And I was thrilled to have a job, and I also, you know, I had two or three screen tests for this, camera tests, and I also auditioned in Dan's office for Bob Costello and Lila Swift, the director, and Dan,
mm-hmm.
Over a period of a couple of months. So obviously, I didn't know, you know, what the show would turn into, but I was thrilled to be working. And I was also incredibly lucky, because all of those things that one learns in drama school about, you know, Shakespeare, Restoration, comedy, and everything, I was able to put to use immediately when Dark Shadows started traveling through the centuries. So, no, I was thrilled.
Laura, let me ask you, did you sit there and at some point think, oh, brother, you know, what did I get myself into, or was this like... a joyride?
Well, very much like Kathryn, it was my first professional job. I'd worked in summer stock, and I'd worked in university theater, and I'd worked in the theater at the University of Iowa where I went to graduate school, but I'd never made more than $50 a week in summer stock. And I went to New York on a whim. I was only planning to stay a couple of weeks because I had met an agent, and he had said, why don't you come to New York and we'll see if we can get you some work. I didn't really expect very much, and I got the part on Dark Shadows the first week I was there. So like Kathryn, I was, I couldn't believe my good fortune. I was thrilled and ready to work. I mean, ready to learn mm-hmm. how to do it. It's not easy when you've had the luxury of rehearsing plays for months and mm-hmm. developing characters for months. And because what we did is we had four rehearsals in the morning, and then we went down on the set and blocked the show for the cameras, and then had a run through. If we were lucky, we had a dress rehearsal, and then we went on the air. And we were not directly on the air, but we were what's called live on tape. Everything we did went right out without cutting or editing or stopping for mistakes. So it was difficult. It was really hard, you know, for an inexperienced.
Yeah. Every day you guys had to learn a new script, and were they changing it right up until
sometimes they did. Sometimes it got too long. It had to fit into the half hour with all the commercials. And they would come and they would cut lines, and we had to remember not to say them.
Yeah.
I remember one of the things that Kathryn said to me when I first got on the show is, she said, you probably won't get any better at your art, but you'll sure improve your technique. And she was right. I mean, you end up with ice water in your veins. You learn to work very fast and fluidly, and after a while, the part is yours, and then it's just a matter of learning the lines. And
yeah, it's very much a deal that you, as the actors and actresses, you're learning under fire. You know, you're going, I even mentioned last week with Kathryn, I said, Jonathan Frid said his English accent was atrocious, but that's okay because, you know, it was supposed to be fake anyway. And a lot of it he attributed to the fact that he was scared to death going out there.
Well, that's what he said. I mean, he did say that agonized look in his eyes when he's looking for his victim or his lost love was really he was searching for the teleprompter and trying to figure out what his next line was.
Whoa. Can I ask Jim, because I know we're going to lose Jim first because he's got a meeting in about 40 minutes. Jim, why did Dan Curtis not try to make this a primetime series?
Well, I mean, the whole thing was, you know, originally Dan had been producing a golf show for CBS because he was a golf nut. He had been a salesman before that, selling old Hopalong Cassidy films in the 50s, and then he sold a couple of things with NBC Films, Union Station, a dramatic show, and then a Grace Kelly from Monaco special. And he decided to harness his love for golf and to producing these televised rounds with professional players and miking them on the course and some innovative techniques. And that ran for CBS Golf Classic, ran for a decade, and won him an Emmy, and it was, so that was the start, and then he sold a cartoon show to CBS called Linus the Lionhearted, and then he did, he decided he wanted to produce shows, and Dark Shadows, he loved gothic mystery stories, and he knew Leonard Goldberg at ABC, and Ed Vane, and in New York, and then he came up with the idea that they needed to have something in daytime. I think Dan just liked the idea of the storytelling process, the serialized format, and you didn't really have that going on in prime time. That was, you know, before Peyton Place came on around that time. But you know, it was just daytime was a good fit for it for an upstart producer to not jump into prime time right away. You know, and he jumped to prime time. You know, as Dark Shadows aired, he did a prime time Jekyll and Hyde special with Jack Palance.
And I love that one. I love that one. Yeah. I have it on tape.
Yeah, and then he did a pilot a couple years later called Dead of Night that was shot on tape. And but then he got into the film format with the Dark Shadows movies and became a director, and then started directing TV movies and on the West Coast for ABC, and moved on from there. So it was all a natural progression, you know, and that was the storytelling started it off.
I have not been able to read any of Laura's books yet, but Kathryn, Laura, and I believe Jim, are you going to be at the festival in Tarrytown this summer?
Yes.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, actually, yeah, it's next month. Yeah.
It is. It's next summer.
It's the last weekend in July.
Yeah, I'm going. My daughter and I are going to go, and it'll be the first time I've gone to one. The book that I did read, all of you had a little bit of input in, Laura and Jim and everybody, and it's The Dark Shadows Return to Collinwood. And it's written by Kathryn Leigh Scott and Jim Pierson with a foreword by Jonathan Frid. You all seem to have forged lifelong friendships and respect for each other when I read about you.
Oh, yeah.
But I think that that's true. And I think that what's really interesting is that as much as, you know, we've supported the fandom, the fans have supported us because they haven't kept us pigeonholed in just the roles that we played on Dark Shadows. They've watched us grow and do other acting things. But even more importantly, when we all started writing, they embraced that as well. So, David Selby has written several books, including a novel. Laura's written several novels and several other books that she's published. And then Marie Wallace and Christopher Pennock. And, you know, there's so many of us that have done other things that the fans have really embraced. And really, that's part of the strong bond that we have.
Yeah, Laura, you earned a master's degree in creative writing, and now you teach English. Is that still, you're still teaching English?
Well, I'm not teaching right now in the summer.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's over for you guys. We're still in school.
I'm teaching. I'm an adjunct at Santa Monica College.
Mm-hmm.
I normally teach in the fall when they need teachers desperately. I teach freshman English.
Mm-hmm. It's wonderful that you are do any of your students ever come up to you and say, oh my God, you're Angelique?
I think it's been too many generations, but every once in a while their mothers figure it out, which is kind of fun.
Okay.
I think Los Angeles teenagers are sort of jaded when it comes to mini celebrities, you know.
Yeah,
so many.
I lived out in California. Let me put it this way. I spent a whole decade there 1 year. And then I really wanted to come back to the East Coast. You know, it was a long time ago, and it wasn't quite like it is now, you know. So it was different. It was during the war, Vietnam War and all that. So, you know, it wasn't quite as much fun for us over there. But, Kathryn, your writing ability, we were talking about that. You all seem to have embraced, all of you have seemed to embrace your characters and just rolled with it and gone to the next logical position of writing stories and continuing the sagas. Have you, Kathryn, done the audio things too?
Yes, I've got two. Actually, I've got several of these out. Dark Shadows Companion, with Jonathan Frid, Lara Parker, Roger Davis, and myself. That's been out now for a few months on CD. And then there's Dark Shadows Memories, which I read. And then, as you know, I've published several other books on entertainment subjects, including Fugitive Recaptured. And that's, so there are other books that I've got on CD and so on as well.
And your site is?
Oh, mine is KathrynLeighScott.com, and I should say this. In fact, I'm going to say it. If anybody has Mr. Google's home phone number, please give it to me, because I am just outraged. For the last 4 days, there was a virus, which we took care of immediately. I mean, those things pop up all the time.
Yeah.
But now there's a warning sign that says malware, and you can't get past it. And the only way to lift it is through Google. And they are very, very slow on this. As a matter of fact, I've heard that there are people who've tried to sue Google because they're so slow at repairing this. But my website is KathrynLeighScott.com. And if you see the malware pop up, press the button that says you're going in anyway, because it's safe.
It's safe, yeah. It's just one of those glitches now.
It's maddening.
I know. I've been trying. I said, I've been on this site for 3 weeks, you know, researching. And I said, you know, I can't get on it now. I don't know what I did wrong. So I had.
Well, that's the problem.
Yeah, the tech is sitting here looking, saying, I don't know what you did. You know, I don't know what I did either. You know, I just talked to guests. I don't know all this stuff about this, you know. But, Laura, what is your site?
It's LaraParker.com.
Mm-hmm. And you have...
L-A-R-A, Lara Parker.
Yeah. And you have your books listed there. And Jim, do you have your own site?
No. I let the gal take care of their stuff. I'm just keep the dark shadows going as best I can. Yeah.
Well, could I just say that if it weren't for Jim Pierson doing all that he has done, there wouldn't be all of this Dark Shadows merchandise. There wouldn't be the DVDs. There wouldn't be the 1,225 episodes available on MPI. You know, absolutely not, including this new Johnny Depp and Tim Burton film.
Mm-hmm.
So much of this has to do with all of the everything that Jim does behind the scenes, and also the Dark Shadows Festival. I mean, he really doesn't get credit enough for the hard work that he puts in.
We're one big collaboration. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you are the man behind the scenes that makes all the magic happen. And, you know, kudos to you. And you also were liaison man for Jonathan Frid to come to the movie and everything. We have to go to break. And during the break, we're going to play, after the commercials, Caesar Must Be Paid. We are going to do the Dark Shadows theme, and then... the audio from the first time Barnabas shows up at the Collins house, which I always thought was Collins Wood, but there's no S in it. It's Collinwood. I've learned something about this, too. And we're going to be right back. This is GameCon Radio, rocking your world tonight with Kathryn Leigh Scott, Laura Parker, and Jim Pierson. And we're doing a reunion of Dark Shadows. And after the break, we will be taking questions, but you have to give us time to, you know, answer the phone and catch it through, okay? We'll be right back.
Just a reminder, guys, all our talk show hosts here at GameCon Radio volunteer their time, but you can always show your appreciation. Click on the tip jar and give them a little love. I'm sure maybe your predictions will come out a little bit better. And that's how we roll here at GameCon Radio. We rock your game and your paranormal.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We are going to take callers now, and you're going to have to give us a chance because evidently there are a lot of people that want to call in. So the number is 732-707-7709. So just give us a chance to pick up and you know, if you weren't picked up right away, don't get dismayed. You know, you can try again. We have a caller. Yes. Caller?
Hi, how are you?
Hi. And your name?
My name is Sunshine from Tim and Eric's Billion Dollar Movie. How are you?
Okay. Do you have a question, and what is it?
I do. Lara Parker wrote a book called Angelique's Descent, and which is the reason that inspired me to write. And what I would like to know about the original Dark Shadows series is if they're planning at all to revive it on television so that the younger generation can get a chance to see it on TV.
Are you asking me?
No, I'm asking Jim Pierson.
You should ask Jim Pierson.
I don't know.
That's what I said. I'm asking Jim Pierson if he's there. Would he know?
Yeah, I think we lost Jim because he was on the cell phone.
Yeah, you might have lost him, but it is true. It's coming on, and Jim is the keeper of that information. It's supposed to start sometime in July. But,
on the regular TV? Wait. On the regular TV station?
Yeah, on a regular, it's going to be rebroadcast, but Jim hasn't made the announcement yet, and so you're just going to have to wait until he comes back online, because he knows the answer to that one.
You know, that's okay. I didn't know that, but if you could ask him, that would be a wonderful thing, because I have tons of fans that watch Tim and Eric that really need to watch Dark Shadows. It's an awesome gothic soap opera, man. I want them to see it so bad.
Okay.
Well, let me ask you a question, Sunshine. Do you think it would be more interesting to watch it rebroadcast so that you had to actually sit down on your couch and watch it when it came on, or do you prefer watching it on a DVD?
I prefer watching it on my 50-inch big-screen television in my home. I would love it if it were rebroadcast. Please rebroadcast it.
That is definitely going to happen.
God bless you. Is this Kathryn Leigh Scott?
It is, and I'm speaking for Jim here, only because I've been hounding him to tell me when it's going to be on.
Oh, bless you. Thank you. You've made my day. I've got a beach party in Redondo on Friday. I'm going to let him know that you guys are going to do it.
Well, I've made Laura's day, too, because we're all going to get residuals again.
Oh, that's wonderful. I know that feeling. God bless you. That's wonderful. I know it'll make your day, too. That's fantastic. Thanks for taking my call.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye. Yeah, we're going to try to bring Jim back on. The residuals, how does that work when it's on the air? You get paid like a pittance for it, right? Is that
what it is a pittance. It is. It's not a lot, but it is, you know, it's something.
It's better than
it's milk money.
Yeah, it's better.
Mad money.
Yeah, you know, it validates what you've done, which is awesome. And
it keeps the series alive. I mean, once again, it's resurrected, and that's great.
Yeah.
You know, the reason why I asked Sunshine that question is that as a member of the Television Academy and Motion Picture Academy, I get all of these DVDs. And you know, it's never as much fun watching a DVD as it is watching something in the theater, the movie theater, or, you know, watching it on television.
Yeah,
have I lost you?
No, we're trying to get Jim on. I'm listening. Yeah,
we are not available now.
Please
leave your name and phone number.
That's
after
okay.
The
I don't know why I find that funny.
It's a live radio, and that's okay. You're right. I think that watching it on the television and the anticipation for the next one to come the next day, I think
that was
part of it.
It's what they used to call destination television, you know, or destination viewing.
Yeah, really? Because I think that it gave everybody something to look forward to, And so, and it didn't take up so much of your time of the day. Do you know what I mean? So, the, you know, kiddies used to run home, or housewives would be, you know, making peanut butter jelly sandwiches, whatever they did, you know. And that little break, you know, and it was a half hour long. It was just the perfect amount of time. And you weren't getting so much that, you know, it was too much. I think it was perfect the way it is. And if they run it that way again, I mean, you're guaranteed it's going to run 5 years, right?
Well, that would
be nice.
We're
not guaranteed. We're not guaranteed. No. But it does tend to pick up a lot of new fans, and they do become addicted, or they, you know, they become faithful followers of it.
Yeah.
There are a lot of stories, and they are wonderful stories, and they hold your attention, no doubt about it.
The writings were
marvelous.
Did they ever ask your input on a storyline?
Never.
No, but they did write for the actors and actresses as they came to see what they were capable of doing in terms of developing the character.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't ask you to do something you couldn't do, and they'd write things they knew you did well.
For example, Nancy Barrett, they were aware that she had quite a good singing voice. So when they created the character of Pansy, of course, she became a music hall singer.
Right.
So
yeah,
there were little things like that.
And let's face it, who could be so stoic is Joan Bennett. I mean, she just looked like, you know, she was stoic. And no matter how much we have a caller, okay? Caller?
Hello, this is Alex.
Okay, hello, Alex. Do you have a question?
Yes, hi. Kathryn, I just want to say I love you. I loved you as Maggie. And I recently saw the Star Trek Next Generation episode where you played the Vulcan, and I thought you were fantastic in it.
Well, thank you.
And for Laura, what was the origination of Angelique Laugh? Was it your idea, or was it the producer's idea for the famous Angelique Laugh?
It was written into the script.
Oh, you have the best laugh.
And they never liked my laugh. They always wanted me to laugh harder and louder. And
was perfect.
Thank you.
Are we gonna get you to do that laugh?
No, not tonight.
Oh no! I was hoping we could try to talk you into it, but yeah,
maybe
it's
a little later.
Yeah, it's a sinister laugh for sure. Thank you for calling in.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
You're going to have another caller coming in soon. Cool. And as I said, everybody that's trying to call, just give us a little bit of time. So we did lose Jim, but I do know he has a meeting at 11 o'clock our time. So I'm not sure if we're going to get Jim back. But Jim Pierson has been awesome I'm not going to say resurrecting, because Dark Shadows has been on a lot. Stand by. Okay. Caller?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
Okay, do you have a question?
Yes, I do. I actually have three short questions, one for Jim, one for Kathryn, and one for Laura.
We lost Jim. He's a casualty of war.
Yeah, I heard that he had to go to a meeting, but that's okay. I still have the other two questions I'd like to ask, and I do have another question I'd like to ask Kathryn.
All right.
Yeah. What's your question?
Okay, well, my question from, actually, this question is for me. It's for Kathryn. On Goodreads, the author question and answer things, she mentioned that she actually got to meet Greta Garbo, and that Cary Grant asked her out on a date twice, and she turned her down both times. And I wanted to know, what was Garbo like, and how in the world could somebody say no to Cary Grant? And then my cousin Barbara had a question for Laura, for Kathryn also. She wanted to know that was Return to Collinwood absolutely possibly going to be her last Dark Shadows book? And then my friend Stephanie had a question for Lara, that it seems like she and Kathryn are best friends. And what was it like, you know, being immortal enemies on the show and getting along so well in real life? And what was Laura's experience like going over and doing a cameo on a new movie?
Well, that should take us until about 2 in the morning.
I wasn't going to say that. Wow.
No, it's just that my cousin Barbara and my friend Stephanie, they're too terrified to call in. I said, oh, get over it. I said, I've never done it before either.
Okay, well, wait a minute now. Let me just start at the top very quickly. When I was doing Dark Shadows, I was living on the east side of New York in a little tiny studio apartment, garden apartment, and Greta Garbo lived just 3 blocks away. And I would often run into her on the street, and one day it was pouring rain, and I felt somebody come up, and she just grabbed the tip of my umbrella, pulled it over so it was covering both of us, and walked with me, and it was Greta Garbo.
And
we walked about 3 blocks, and then we cut it, and then I could feel her body movement. She was going to cross on 56th Street, and I moved and walked her across the street, and then I could feel her, you know, pulling away, and I said, "Excuse me, Miss Garbo," and by that, as she was sprinting by that time, but I walked 3 blocks with her, and then Cary Grant.
Oh, that's amazing.
Okay, yeah, and then Cary Grant did call me up twice and ask me out. Actually, we had a mutual friend. And oddly enough, both times that he called me, I was literally getting on a plane. Once I was going to Europe, and the other time I was going to Minnesota. And don't think I didn't think twice about that trip to Minnesota.
I mean, because Kathryn, is it Kathryn?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is.
I mean, you're so beautiful. I mean, I could just see how it would be drawn to you like a magnet. I mean,
let's go to the next question because we got
questions.
The other question is because there's no shortage of beautiful women on that show. I have to tell you that. And good looking guys. I mean, there's a lot of beefsteak on that show.
As little as I was, man, my first crush, I think, was on David Selby.
And how old were you when you were watching this?
I was 5. I started watching it with my brother, and he actually ordered me the 1970s Josette music box out of the back of his famous Monsters of Filmland thing. That was one of the last things he ever gave me. I still have it on my piano today.
All right, we're going to ask the other thing, and we're going to disconnect the phone from you, okay? Because the other questions are how the girls work together and that, so we're going to talk about that. Laura...
If you could mention the question to Laura that she and Kathryn seemed to be best friends, you know, more or less in real life, but they were like mortal enemies on the show, and how ironic it was, and what her cameo was like. And please mention that question is from Stephanie, because she was too chicken to call in, and I told her I was going to deliberately mention her name.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so, Laura, I'm going to ask you... how was it to work, you know, your desperate enemies with Kathryn on screen and your friends off screen?
Well, we became friends, I think better friends after the show went off the air.
Mm-hmm.
But everyone on the show got along. We were like a big happy family, and one of the nice things that happened was if you died, you got to come back playing another role. So we would leave and return, and we formed close relationships and saw each other. There was a little bar down the street. What was the name of it, Kathryn?
Brittany Dussois.
The Brittany Dussois. And we used to go there after we finished with the show and sometimes and have a glass of wine and laugh over the ridiculous things that had happened that day.
You needed to coast down, right? Like, unwind, yeah.
Yeah.
And
And I think the fact that we were mortal enemies, I think that's kind of an overstatement. I just think that, you know, we both had a role to play, and Catherine's role, Josette was in the dark. She didn't really realize that her maid, to whom she was quite devoted, was plotting plotting all these misfortunes and trying to steal Barnabas away from her. And she was quite innocent. So it's not as though we were playing mortal enemies, if you know what I mean.
Well, I touched on this last week, and you have to, and I guess it speaks volumes with Dan Curtis and Wallace and the way they wrote the storyline. But back in the 1700s, you had the rich guy who was busy doing the nasty with the poor servant girl, but he married the one who was going to carry, you know, help the business, bring money, you know, the one that was going to look good. So in a very real way, historically, that's accurate with a lot of these guys. I mean, Thomas Jefferson married the girl with the money and everything. Meanwhile, he had the handmaid that lived in the house, and she was having children by him. So, you know, historically, so in a way, you can see that Barnabas himself set up that rivalry.
Well, I think that the triangle worked very well for keeping the show going. It was kind of the heart and soul of the show. And when they went off on other stories, they sort of would come back to Barnabas, Josette, and Angelique. But the truth was, Barnabas loved Josette.
Right.
He did not love Angelique. So it wasn't really as though he was fooling around with the maid and marrying the wealthy girl for her money.
Well, didn't they have a prior relationship in the story first?
Yes. Before my character appeared, and this is actually the plot of the first novel I wrote, Angelique's Descent.
Okay, excuse me, I have to cut you in. We have a caller. Okay, bring him up. I'm sorry. Hello, caller.
Hi, how are you?
Okay, can I have your name?
Yeah, my name is Rachel. I called you earlier.
Okay, hi, Rachel. You have
hi.
A question?
I do. You know what I'd like to know? I'd like to know if all of the existing living original cast members would ever be petitioned to make a show either in cartoon style or over the radio or the internet and reprise their original characters. I was wondering if maybe that could be done. And I've been listening to the show, so I understand that Jim's not there. But maybe even Lara Parker or Kathryn Leigh Scott might know or be able to touch on that.
You know, someone that was brought up in the Laura, were you answering that one?
Yeah.
No, go ahead. Oh, okay. No, but I only know that, you know, Jim gets approached by people with all kinds of ideas, and indeed that was something that I think I got as an email and forwarded it to him. You know, doing an animated version, of course, that's come up.
Yeah, do you think you might? Or do you not
well,
have a
you know, and, if somebody did it, first of all, Warner Brothers owns it now, and if they wanted to do, I mean, they're well known for animation. If they were to do an animated version, and if they were to offer Laura and me roles on it, we'd leap at it.
I think that would be wonderful because
there's nothing like that happening at the moment. It's just a daydream.
Well, I think they should make it a reality because there's Christopher Pennick and James Thorne and all those other people out there, with, of course, with you and Laura and David Selby. I think it would be a wonderful moneymaker, and we would all be thrilled, so it would be wonderful. Who's
well, we would
to
be
do it
thrilled,
again?
Too. But, you
I
know,
mean,
we're...
Okay, whoa.
Yeah,
Rachel,
we're already doing these CDs, you know. We already, all of us, go into these studios and do these CDs with new dramas for Big Finish. So this would simply be, you know, one other thing that we would do.
Right, and it sounds like you're really, really busy, but if you ever have time, we would sure like to see that. We really would. And I just wanted to share that with you. Thank you so much for taking my call.
Thank you for calling in. Yeah, you, Jonathan Frid and John Carlin, Laura, you, Kathryn, you've all kind of been involved in this CD, like, recording thing, right?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, and it seems like it's starting to take off really huge. I have to admit, I was not aware of all that was going on in the dark shadow world. You know, I mean, yeah, because, you know, I went on and had my family and, you know, all that goes, you know, everything that goes on with that. And then, I was telling Kathryn, I got my PC and found MySpace, and, suddenly there were people doing reenacting, and they were like, you know, Maggie Evans and Josette Dupre, and I'm like, what the heck, you know? And I guess I've been under a rock someplace, because up until 3 years ago, I had no idea how popular this show has been, and it just seems now it's just getting more momentum. What do you feel about that, Laura?
Well, I think that it kind of became part of the pop cultural phenomenon along with the movie. I mean, it came back into it got more attention than it, I mean, we've had the conventions every year, and it's been on DVDs, and yes, we've been doing the recordings and publishing our books, but there's a lot of renewed interest because of the Johnny Depp Tim Burton movie, and now a lot of people who, like you, didn't really realize that it still had so many fans and so great a following, have now sort of rediscovered it, which is wonderful for all of us. I mean, we're all excited. We're excited about the movie. We're excited about the fact that we, four of us, got to go and be on the set in outside of London at Pinewood Studios and perform cameos and get to meet all of the actors and actresses who were in the new film. So I think it's created a lot of attention.
Yeah, they looked at you like you were gods. I mean, really. Thank you so much. I had gotten a picture of you guys, Jonathan Frid, David Selby, and you two lovely, lovely ladies walking in through the door, meeting the new Johnny Depp, Barnabas, and Laura and Kathryn both signed this picture. It's lovely. Where can they get these signed pictures?
Well, both of us have them for sale on our website.
Very cool. The Dark Shadows Day at Collinswood Festival is going to be at the Lyndhurst. It's a park now, but Lyndhurst Mansion, 635 South Broadway in Tarrytown, New York. And you go on to, if you just Google darkshadowsfestival.com, you're going to find it. And there's going to be, on the 28th, celebrating the new Dark Shadows movie, including cameos by Kathryn, Laura, and is David Selby supposed to still be there?
I don't think he's coming.
I couldn't do this show because he was working.
Yes, he's in a play, and I think the play opens the same weekend, or he's in rehearsal.
Yeah. And then the next day is a luncheon. And you go to this site and you can order tickets, because you do have to be reserved. You know, they have a limit and you have to reserve your spaces. And again, that would be darkshadowsfestival.com. And my daughter and I are going. It will be my first time going to one of these. Any suggestions?
Oh, come early. No, they're expecting a huge crowd, especially because of the movie, because of the books, because of the CDs. There's been a lot of promotion, so we're expecting a huge crowd, so come early.
Okay, yeah. And walking shoes, because Lyndhurst is big.
It's a lot of fun to look at, and if you saw either one of the Dark Shadows films,
before the Tim Burton film.
Mm-hmm.
They were filmed there, so you can see the various locations. And it's
we're going to go to break, and when we come back, I'd like to ask you, what's your favorite memory? You each must have a specific thing that every time your mind goes to it, you go right to that point, and it's got to be like your favorite memory. It doesn't necessarily have to be a part. It could be something silly that happened, you know, during a downtime or whatever. And I also want to talk to you, about the, the going to England and what it was like, because that had to be a great honor for you guys. We're going to be playing Josette's Music Box after the next commercials, and we'll be right back. This is Game Con Radio, and Lara Parker and Kathryn Leigh Scott are our guests. We lost Jim, please know that he is there. I think that he is instrumental in the revival of all things Dark Shadows. We'll be right back. This is Game Con Radio.
You are listening to Game Con Radio.
Got questions.
Who are we?
Where do we come from?
Are we alone in the universe?
Is there life after death?
Where can I take a class and really learn about demonology?
Now, get the answers. For a decade, the American Institute of Metaphysics has offered the ultimate in courses designed to serve as the foundation in your search for life's questions. The courses cover a variety of subject areas and consist of wide-ranging alternative sciences, theories, and philosophies. Each course comes complete with textbooks, work materials, and instructions. The courses allow you the freedom to pursue your own areas of interest according to your schedule. Whether it's UFOs, life after death, demonology, cryptozoology, and more, you've got questions. We've got answers. Visit www.instituteofmetaphysics.com or call 877-623-3241 and start your search now.
Yes?
I'd like to see Mrs. Stoddard, if you'd be so kind.
Mrs. Stoddard?
This is Collingwood, isn't it?
Yes.
And the mistress here is Mrs. Elizabeth Collin Stoddard, is she not?
Yes.
Then perhaps you'd do me the courtesy to inform Mrs. Stoddard that her cousin is calling and wishes to pay his respects.
Cousin?
Yes, her cousin from England.
From England? Oh, please, come in.
I'd be delighted, thank you.
Would you like to wait in the drawing room?
Here would be fine, thank you.
Oh, well, I'll let Mrs. Stark know you're here.
Oh, madam, if you would, you may tell her that it's Barnabas Collins.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your game. Tonight, we're rocking your world with Kathryn Leigh Scott and Lara Parker. Jim Pierson from Dan Curtis Productions had to attend a meeting, and he's not sure he's going to make it back, but if he can, he will. Last week, Kathryn came on and talked about her books, and in a minute we're going to have Lara talk about hers, because I have to tell you, I read Kathryn's book, Dark Shadows, Return to Collingwood, and Dark Passages, and loved them. Literally, the one, Return to Collingwood, beautiful pictures in there. I love the very the way everybody did their little bit in it. Jonathan Frid did the foreword. Laura did some, contributed to it. I love the way everybody talks very caringly about each other and about the work they did, and certainly they should be proud. But first, let me ask, Lara, yeah. Your one thought, your one, when somebody says, oh, do you remember Dark Shadows, one incident that just tickles your fancy to no end?
Well, there were so many, because as I said, we had so little rehearsal, and often things would go wrong on the set. But one thing that went really, really well was in the second film when I was hung as a witch, hanged, I think I'm supposed to say, hanged as a witch. And they got me up on the scaffold, and the noose was hanging from a huge leafless tree. A giant tree, a dead oak tree. And I said, you know, we'll get a stunt girl to do the actual hanging. And I said, isn't there, what is she going to do? Isn't there some way I can do it? And they said, well, I guess if you want. And so they put a harness underneath my dress, which completely held, it was like a sort of a life jacket. And it had a hook on the back, and on the back they attached the rope that went through the noose so that the noose never really tightened around my neck. I was hanging from this rope attached to this corset on the in the back. And I jumped off a couple of times, kind of bounced around, and I realized that I could do this. So I got to do the hanging scene and kind of kick my feet and croak my neck over to the side, and it was great. I thought it, I mean, when I saw it, I was very impressed. So, you know, things like that I remember. I think what I remember the most is just running down the stairs in costume with all the little curls tacked onto the back of my head and running onto the set with everyone else there and feeling like every night, every day was opening night of a play, because we were always so excited and there was so much adrenaline in the air.
Yeah, I'm looking at the picture of you hanging in the book, and page 187. And I remember when I was reading it and I looked and I said, wow, that doesn't look like something I'd want to do. And Grayson Hall is looking like, oh, brother. And David Selsby looks like he's doing some kind of karate moves or something. And there you are with your neck cocked over.
I think that was a posed picture, but nevertheless,
yeah.
It's quite impressive.
Yeah. It is. You know, that stuff is fun. And I guess, yeah, I can understand how it's like having an opening day every day, and the script is different, so it's like being in a different play every day. The character might be similar, but the words and all are all different. The script is different, you know. Even if you're carrying on the same kind of scene, it's got to be new each day. It sounds like it's wonderful. Kathryn, what tickles you more than anything when you think back and go, oh man, that was it, you know, that one moment?
Oh, that one moment for me would probably be the first time I saw Jonathan Frid come on the set, and he looked so cowed, because, you know, he showed up with the ring and the cape and the wolf's head cane, and I remember he came into the rehearsal room. Joan Bennett, I know, was there, and we all looked at him, and I think that was the moment when some of the actors thought, oh my God, there goes the career. But he was just, I don't know why, I just remember that image of him. And then a day or two later, I did the episode where he comes into the Cullensport Diner. And that to me, that is my very favorite scene of all the shows that we did. And we were still in black and white, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I somebody asked me the other day, do I really think that we should colorize those earlier episodes? Quite frankly, I think that the show in black and white was in some ways far more compelling, I loved it in black and white, and I was there that when we switched to color, and it was the funniest thing in the world because they were actually testing us with black lipstick. They were doing everything, thinking that we had to do such, so many concessions,
mm-hmm.
and of course we didn't. But again, as Lara says, there are just so many memories. I mean, there were so. We were all by ourselves in our studio. We weren't in the big ABC complex, sharing space with a lot of other soap operas. We were all by ourselves, and I think that's also what engendered that family atmosphere.
Okay.
And when we went up to the Brittany Dussois, Dan Curtis would be up there, and I remember the day he got into a fight with the makeup man. And he broke his finger, and it never straightened out, and he was never able to play a good golf game after that. But there were so many crazy things that happened, and I've tried to capture them in the behind-the-scenes anecdotes that, over the years, I've put into the Dark Shadows books. But, you read the books, I'm
you're
so
there.
Glad I did them,
you're
because
there.
Otherwise
yeah.
these stories would have been forgotten.
Yeah, you're there. Lara, you have the fire story, too, that, they kept putting lighter fluid on it, so it would be...
Yeah. Well, I had to do it with... I had to do often an incantation, which was half a page of dialogue, calling on the powers of darkness and the forces of evil and the devil and the sky and the sea and the air and everything else that witches call on to cast spells. And I was trying to start a fire in Vicky's room, and I was doing this with a house of cards. I mean, it's probably hard for you to grasp, but it was a spell, and when I'd lit the house of cards, it was going to start a fire on the floor of her bedroom. And so first I had to build a house of cards, which was a trick in itself, getting the cards to stand up vertically and then put the top cards on and then the next level. And then we went to commercial, just like we've done on your show, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then we went to commercial, and when we came back from commercial, the whole idea was for me to take a candle and set fire to the house of cards. Well, during the commercial, a prop man came over and squirted lighter fluid all over it so that it would be sure and catch. And my incantation, which was to go on for about 20 lines, ended with the words burn, burn, burn. So we waited, one commercial went by, and then the prop man thought maybe he should do a little bit more squirting. So he came over and squirted a little bit more lighter fluid. Anyhow, we came back up to the show, and I picked up the candle, and I started the incantation, and I set it over to the house of cards, and it did this enormous explosion. It just went poof, singed off my eyelashes and my eyebrows, and immediately burned up. And there was nothing left but ashes, and I still had all of this curse to say. And I finally got to the end, and I said, burn, burn, but there was nothing burning. It was burned away. So I just picked up the ashes and kind of let them flicker down on the table, and I said, burn, burn. It was ridiculous. It was ridiculous.
And you thank God your eyebrows were still there.
Yeah, but, it was... It was almost so funny that I almost started laughing, so...
Actually,
but I was too scared.
Actually, there is one scene, and I can't remember what it is, but I think it's in, a blooper thing where John Carlin's kneeling at a grave site, and the announcer is, talking, I guess it's one of you ladies talking, in the beginning, what's going on? A man is in the cemetery. And whatever was said, John Carlin actually starts giggling and says, now that's funny. and I saw that. It seemed like everybody took everything in stride because there was no other way to survive it, huh?
Well, there was no editing.
Lara's alluding to that by saying, how she handled that. That's the sort of thing. It's a kind of ad-libbing and making do that you do when mm-hmm. you're doing a stage play or summer stock, you know.
Right.
We were live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were.
Yeah, I remember seeing Kathryn and Jonathan Frid interviewed by Lloyd Bridges and Gary something or another. And Lloyd Bridges says, oh, can you, yeah, you notice I liked Lloyd Bridges. I remember him. He was very good looking when he was young.
Especially in the wet suit.
Oh, my God. yeah, you know, he was built like a brick shit house. Anyway, he's sitting there and he says, oh, you were able to take the film and transpose it because the way it was originally recorded, you had to wait a few days even though it was recorded live, you didn't have retakes. Then it had to be transposed somehow to get you on. So it was as if you were watching what you did a few days ago. Is that kind of how it went?
Well, we watched the show on the air about a week later, unless we had somehow gotten behind.
Uh-huh.
So we'd finish with the show for the day, and then we'd go up to this little green room that we had, and we'd watch the show that we had taped the week before.
Mm-hmm.
But there had been no editing of any kind, so that all of the mistakes we made went right on the air. And if a fly landed on your nose, or you forgot your lines, or you called someone by the wrong name, or you knocked over a styrofoam gravestone, or you slammed the door and the painting fell off the set wall, or just any number of things, microphone came into the shot. Or I think several times, I think there's a story. Do you know the story, Kathryn, of what Jonathan thought he was finished? And
oh, I was there that day. We had what we called a beauty shot, and that's where the camera at the very end would lock on one of the sets while the credits rolled. And, you know, everybody was anxious to get back up to the dressing room, change clothes, and, you know, go to the Brittany the Swath. And Jonathan used to use the room right underneath the staircase, which was where Mrs. Johnson always emerged. That was obviously on, you know, on the way to the kitchen and the scullery mm-hmm. or whatever. And there was a little changing room back there, and it was really where Jonathan, if he had a quick change, made the changes. Well, in the beauty shot one day, you see Jonathan walking out of there, you know, with these clothes hangers over his shoulder, wearing street clothes. And then you see that he knows he's been caught, and then he scurries off. It's the funniest thing in the world.
That's what made it really, it made it good. I loved the show. I mean, it stood a test of time. It hasn't lost any momentum that I could see. Has it ever been a time it hasn't been on the air at all for like decades? I think that maybe the longest time was maybe 8 years that it's not been on the television.
I don't really know.
It's been about that long since it was last rebroadcast.
Yeah, it's always on. I mean, my children saw it in the 80s when it came on Sci-Fi. Now, my youngest had never seen it, because it went off, and of course we were busy doing other things and everything. So Andrew is now watching the CDs with me, you know, and he's like 30 years old. I told Kathryn this last week, my favorite bad guy was Jason McGuire. He was the bad guy you love to hate. He was a scoundrel, but he was a charismatic scoundrel, if you know what I mean. And we were watching it. I just introduced it to my granddaughter, who's going to be 16. And in it, Jason's at the cemetery, and the old guy's talking about Willie being there. And he says, he was pretending to be someone he shouldn't have. And Jason McGuire says, well, if that was a crime, we'd all be in jail. And she broke up laughing. She thought that was so funny. It did have snappy dialogue and that, you know, jokes. It was never boring. The characters all were fresh. You could see them as real people. It didn't come off as, you know, like, it didn't come off stupid, you know, where you went, oh, come on, you know? I mean, and that was a great thing about it. Lara, your books, you've taken on the witches of Dark Shadows in your books, haven't you?
The witches?
Yeah, the Salem branch and that kind of your books. They are
gothic vampire stories. They're fictional. Mm-hmm. They're completely original stories, but they use most of the characters from the original show. I've introduced a few new characters, and the setting is still Collinwood, the great house at Collinwood, and the old house, which is where the vampire's casket is in the basement. So the settings are the same, and most of the characters, Joan Bennett's character of Elizabeth, and Roger, her brother, and Quentin Collins, and of course Jonathan Frid, Barnabas, and Kathryn's character and my character, Josette and Angelique, they're all in the books. But the stories are, the first book, Angelique's Descent, is a completely fictionalized version of my character's childhood in Martinique when she was a little girl, and how she grew up to become a witch, and what the experiences she had that hardened her heart against the world, the main one being the fact that she was seduced and abandoned by this young soldier who she thought intended to marry her. So I was able to write that entire romantic episode, which on the show was only imagined by me, since on the show the romance had already ended, and she had turned into the jealous witch that she was on the Dark Shadow show. So I wanted to tell her story, and the second one, what takes up the Salem branch, starts right after the show went off the air. And at the end of 5 years of 1,225 episodes, when the show went off the air, the vampire had been cured, and he was human again. He'd been cured by Dr. Hoffman, played by Grayson Hall, who she was also in love with him, and she had created an elixir that made him human again, and that's where the Salem branch begins. And he is struggling with his transformation into being human. It's not as much fun as he thought it was going to be. He kind of misses his vampire powers.
Okay, hang on. We have a caller. Can you answer it? Hello, caller.
Hello, this is Captain Celluloid. How are you?
Oh,
hello.
Doing good. And what do you
How's have? Everybody over there?
Okay, very good. Captain,
I wanted to ask a question.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Ladies, for both ladies, they were so believable in their roles. Did they have trouble getting other parts after the show ended its run?
Well, I came to California when the show went off the air, and I began working on nighttime TV. I think Kathryn and I were both very fortunate at that particular period of time. There were a lot of hour-long dramatic shows, and they always had, every week they had a girl on the show. So there were a lot of parts available, and we both we're very fortunate. We worked a lot in episodic and nighttime TV. We did movies of the week. We did a few films. And
so you weren't stereotyped.
Well, no, it's a little bit different in my case because, you know, I left the show about 5 months before it went off the air. I was working without a contract. Yeah, I worked without a contract for about the last year. And I moved to France and then to England, and nobody in France knew who I was, but I ended up doing a couple of feature films there, and then one day I happened to see that on the Champs-Élysées, Le Fiancé de Vampire was playing, and there was a poster of me. So I was very lucky because I lived and worked in England after that for several years, and I did a lot of theater. I worked with Jimmy Stewart and Harvey. I worked at the Bristol Old Vic and in repertory. So there was no chance for me to get, you know, stereotyped or pigeonholed or anything. Nobody really knew Dark Shadows. Let me just finish up. As Lara says, when I did get to California and I ran into Lara and we talked about this, we were just incredibly lucky because it wasn't all of this reality stuff. There were these wonderful shows we could do.
Yes, yeah, I remember Lara on a Rockford Files episode
right.
later on.
Uh-huh.
Lara did that movie with Warren Oates, right?
I did a movie called Race with the
right,
Devil, which
right,
is a horror
Race with
movie.
The Devil with Peter Fonda and Warren
and I
Oates.
Played a very, sweet, innocent, ordinary girl, not out of
complete opposite of Angelique.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, I the reason I asked that question is because I am a big a fan of the Superman TV show.
Uh-huh.
And I had spoken with Jack Larson a couple of years ago, and Jack Larson, after that show ended, he was Jimmy Olsen on that show. He couldn't find a part anywhere after that show.
I've heard that happens.
He was jinxed. He wound up being a producer later on. He just couldn't get anything.
Let me ask. Laura, were you in Save the Tiger?
Yes,
See, so you got a
that
lot...
That was the first job I had in Hollywood, and I actually flew out here to do that role, and it was a part of a prostitute, and that actually typecast me more than Dark Shadows did, because after that, I was cast several more times as a prostitute.
Yeah, and we don't want that, no. Yeah.
I didn't mind. I wanted to thank both ladies for giving me their autographs last summer at the show here in Brooklyn.
Oh, you're so
I appreciate
welcome.
That. You guys rocked last summer. I couldn't believe the lines at the show. I had to cut the line for David Selby. The girls wouldn't let me go to the table to get David Selby's autograph. It was unbelievable. David Selby had a line there, I think, for three straight days.
Are you telling me I'm going to need to bring the wheelchair when I go get this thing?
Oh, my God.
I'm going to have to bring the wheelchair then because I won't be able to
Well, you don't have to stand in those lines unless you want to.
Well,
and
of
ladies,
course,
ladies, thank you. I want to thank both ladies for doing this online because we don't get to hear you often online, and this is great.
Well,
you are coming in as clear as a bell on this end.
They sound like they just finished an episode of Dark Shadows, don't they?
Yeah. I mean, it seems like yesterday. Everybody's getting a thrill out of it on
the
chat box.
I'm over the moon.
I want to thank you for being there. Mo is a class act. She's already put me through the ringer. So having you on for 2 weeks, Miss Scott, is it's been a pleasure listening to you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you, Terry. Thank you so much for calling in. We're going to go to break, and then we're going to let our two lovely ladies leave after we give you links and tell you where you can buy the books. But we're going to go to a break now, and the last song, I believe, is Quentin's theme, and you'll hear that right after the commercials. And this is Game Con Radio, rocking your world tonight with Lara Parker and Kathryn Leigh Scott from Dark Shadows, the serial from 1966. And it's as popular today as it was in 1960. I think it's more popular. Nobody knew what it was in 1966. I mean, my father, I came home, my father was sitting there, he says, I don't know, there's something coming on. It's something like this girl who doesn't know who she is or something. And he was hooked first. So, I love this show, and I think now more people know about it, and I think it's wonderful, and you did such great work. It's wonderful to see a lifetime of work still rewarding you with people knowing who you are. We'll be right back. This is Game Con Radio.
Hey, little girl. What would you do for a Klondike bar? Game Con Radio. The station your mother warned you about.
Yes? Hi, I'm here for the New York Ghost Tour.
Sorry, we're closed. But you can come back next week.
Next week? Forget that. I'll just go check out another place.
Trust me, there's no place half as interesting as ours, dear.
That's so not true. What about the Shanley Hotel in Napanock?
Once you've been to one haunted hotel, you've been to them all.
Not like this place. The Shanley Hotel dates back to 1845, and since then it's been a hotspot for paranormal activity. Mysterious music, smells, whistling, doors opening, footsteps, almost everything you can imagine has been experienced at that hotel.
It's open to the public?
Absolutely. Sal and Cindy, the owners of the hotel, welcome people for regular stays or investigations, and their rates are beyond reasonable. They even offer workshops and in-house psychics.
How did you learn about this place?
By visiting www.shanleyhotel.com. You can get history, investigation info, and much more.
Thanks, I think I will. Just don't tell any of our customers.
Your secret's safe with me. It's not like anyone can...
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio, and our very special guests tonight are Lara Parker and Kathryn Leigh Scott. And yes, I keep changing their names back and forth because, you know, they both were such integral parts of the original series Dark Shadows, and there were two movies, you know, that came out of it. And it's kind of like a dynasty, I would suppose, that these are the ladies who defined who Angelique and Maggie Evans and Josette were. And everybody who portrays those characters now are stepping off of the work that they did in 1966 through 1971 and then in the two movies. So it's an incredible legacy these ladies have left television history. It is just history, and I thank you so much for coming on and sharing a little bit of it with you. You both will be at the Dark Shadows Festival Saturday, July 28th, 2012, at Lyndhurst, 635 South Broadway, Tarrytown, New York. You have to go on the site, which is darkshadowsfestival.com, and buy tickets. Anybody interested has to buy the tickets because they do sell out. I know there's a cap on how many people they can have and that sort of thing. So please, if you're interested in going, because I'm going, please order your tickets on the site now. And let me just, before the ladies give you all their information, just a little nod to Jonathan Frid, because Dark Shadows was going to be canceled up until a very geeky, awkward vampire showed up. He was a vampire, not comfortable in his own skin, and not comfortable with anybody else's blood in his veins either. And it made it perfect. He was the first vampire that you felt sorry for. And I think that there's no one who can argue that he was instrumental in that show going the distance it did. And rest in peace. God bless him. He was a fantabulous, as I would call it, actor. He was a Shakespearean actor. He was very serious about his craft. And from everything I've ever heard about him, he was a total gentleman. Would you ladies agree?
Absolutely, yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, he seemed like a really nice guy. And I've never heard that he wasn't a nice guy. So, I mean, you know, everybody has a bad day, but, I mean, he seemed like he really,
he had a little trouble digesting it all in the beginning, but after a while, okay, this is it. You know, I'm Barnabas. Yeah, I'm Barnabas. You know, he took it within stride, and he created a television icon too, Barnabas Collins. There's anybody who loves horror films and that kind of thing, they all know who Barnabas Collins is. Laura, your site again, and tell us the books that you have out.
Yes, it's laraparker.com, LaraParker, and I have two books, Angelique's Descent and The Salem Branch, which goes back in, and a lot of the book takes part during the Salem witch hunt.
Mm-hmm.
The third book comes out in October, and it's called Wolf Moon Rising. And it tells the story of Quentin, who was another very popular character on the show, and the werewolf curse.
Mm-hmm.
So not only is there a lot of vampirism, there's also the werewolf. So it's very exciting, and it's also introduces the romance of the young David, who is now 16, and he's in love with a girl who is a reincarnation of Angelique. Her name is Jacqueline, and so it tells their love story as well. So mm-hmm. it's packed with a lot of original stories with the real Dark Shadows flavor. And I'd just like to add two things. One, I hope everyone will go and see the film. I think that Johnny Depp's characterization, although very different from Jonathan Pridd's, is absolutely marvelous. He's a wonderful, versatile actor, and he has captured a different kind of Barnabas, but just as mysterious and just as fascinating. And yes, Jonathan Pridd was, we all say every single year, that we attribute to him and his marvelous, charismatic characterization, we attribute the success of Dark Shadows really to him. Mm-hmm. I think he's the one that lifted it out of the shadows and into the light and made it as remarkable as it was.
Let me ask you, before Kathryn gives us her information, you both went to England, and it kind of hinged on Jonathan being able to go, and I understand he was up in years and all of that. But, you know, when he and Johnny Depp met, yeah, there's no way Johnny Depp could try to be the Barnabas that Jonathan
right.
Pridd was. There's just no
right.
way. Ben Cross did very well. I really liked him in the miniseries that they did. I really liked that and was really bummed
yeah,
out
was
that
good
they
too.
Did it. Yeah. But Johnny Depp took it a whole new window. But still, Barnabas is quirky, and
mm-hmm.
he's a fish out of water. And
yeah.
now the timing, he's in 72 with lava lamps and asking a 15-year-old about dating tips and stuff. It was a good movie. It was way different, and I enjoyed it, but at first we were kind of like, wow, you know, but I think that's...
But it's very entertaining. It's very entertaining.
It is.
And it's also very, very beautiful.
It is.
I mean,
it's
Tim Burton has a painter's touch, and it's wonderful to see what he does with the lighting.
I love the McDonald arcs. Arches.
Yeah, right.
That's hysterical. You know, he's
yeah.
looking at, and he's yeah, Mephistopheles. You know, it
right.
is.
Mephistopheles.
It's a good movie.
Mephistopheles, right.
How did you feel doing that cameo on there?
Oh, it was. Well, we were all very, very excited and thrilled to be there, and they treated us like movie stars. You know,
mm-hmm.
they said many, many times, you were our inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
And when Johnny Depp met Jonathan Pridd, he gestured to these incredible sets, this huge stairway and hallway, and we were surrounded by this magnificence that only, you know, great movie making can produce. And he just said, all of this, none of this would be here if it weren't for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, none of us would be here if it weren't for you. And
And
very gracious.
Jonathan kind of nodded and, in a sense, you know, spiritually handed the torch of the older Barnabas to the younger Barnabas. But it was really a moving moment to see the two of them together. And Kathryn and David Selby and I were just overjoyed and very, very flattered that we were asked to participate in this film. And then I think it was a real nod, an homage to our show and to our work and to, you know, the fact that we've kept the Dark Shadows flame alive all these years by showing up at the festivals and appearing and writing books and continuing to encourage the fans to, you know, not let go of this legacy.
Yeah, it seems like some of the people who love the old series are having a little trouble, you know, embracing the new one. But I tried to make an analogy when the first Star Trek movie came out, Star Trek the motion picture. Everybody was telling me, "Oh my goodness, it was so boring! It was so boring! It was so boring!" And I said, "But you have to understand, where have they been for 20 years? You can't just have Captain Kirk coming back out and he's still on the Enterprise. You can't do that, you know." Okay. So I was kind of, you know, I said, I liked it. I wanted to know where he was. So maybe there's a new, what do you call it? And maybe there's a sequel in it for...
Well, I think that the film was made by Johnny Depp and Tim Burton because they were fans.
Right.
Because they had all their lives wanted to do this. It was made with great affection. And I do not think it's boring.
No, it's not.
Whatever you said about the Star Trek movie, I think it's filled with wonderful goodies for the fans and things that they can delight in and savor. So it's just, you know, slight, it has a different tone.
Oh yeah, it's totally action and there's giggles in it and there's things you would expect him to have to deal with, you know. It's been 200 years and everything, but still they had to try to kind of step it up. In 2 hours they didn't have 5 years of half-hour series to get the whole story going, so they had to put it on fast. And Kathryn, please share with us where your books can be found and everything.
My books can be found in fine bookstores everywhere, and also, you know, I have a publishing company, Pomegranate Press, so I publish books about a lot of classic television and guidebooks and all sorts of things. So the best thing to do is to go on KathrynLeighScott.com or PomPress.com, and there's a catalog there, and you can order using PayPal. And I just want to say this again because it's been so upsetting to me. But it's safe to go to those sites. There is a sign that pops up that says, you know, warning. But there's no virus there, and I'm just waiting for Google to take that warning down. But I think PayPal is a terrific boon. So go to the websites and just check out what's there.
Very cool. And they're great books, and I'm going to go to the festival and I'm going to be buying books from both of you and getting them signed. And I can't wait. We're really excited to go. Like I said, this will be my first time going there. So
I think there's still a Barnes in all the Barnes and Nobles all over the country. There's still a Dark Shadows exhibit, a table, or a rack of some kind with all of our books.
Okay. If I buy some and bring them there, would you sign them?
Of course.
Okay. I'm going to walk up, this brat's going to walk up with Kane and say Mo, and you're going to go, "Holy crap, that's her."
Or you can get them there.
Yeah,
so, or
we can buy them there, yeah. I want to thank you both for coming on, and please tell Jim thank you for coming on. I understand he had a meeting. This was awesome, and you are part, like it or not, embracing it. I'm sure you do. You're part of television history, and I think there should be a Dark Shadows exhibit right next to the MASH one at the Smithsonian.
Maybe there will be.
Yeah, really, because, I mean, it was on, and it's made such a huge impact, and they have the MASH exhibit there from the TV show. I think that, you know, it's wonderful that the legacy is still going on, and I think it's wonderful that you were able to be in the new movie with Johnny Depp for a cameo. And God bless you both, and thank you so very much for coming on tonight.
Okay, it's been a lot of fun. Thank you.
Okay, all you have to do is hang up, and I'll email you with the link to the recordings when you're done, okay?
Okay. Thank you so
much. Thank you, Mo. Bye-bye.
God bless.
Bye.
That was an extraordinary show. Again, Kathryn Leigh Scott has a site, and also Lara, L-A-R-A, Parker has a site. Very accomplished ladies, beautiful ladies, and television history, there is no doubt about it. I hope that you enjoyed the music. Evidently, in the chat room, both Negative Trait and I are using the same name or something. It keeps signing me out, and whenever he writes, my name is on it. So that's kind of threw me off for a few minutes there. I was looking at that saying, I didn't write anything. But anyway, I'm going to do a little bit of Crazy Butt News, if I can find it. And we do that, and I want to remind everybody that it's summer, and when children get hot and bored, they're going to be looking for ways to cool off. You can't turn your back on children. If you've got a pool in the backyard, you've got to make sure there's no way for that child to get in there when you're not looking, because as much as we want to think our children would never, ever go into a pool without us knowing, children are still children, and so please be careful with bodies of water, pools of water, with your children. Keep an eye on them. It's summertime, and we don't want to hear about anybody's child being hurt. They're going into moving rivers and streams thinking that they're going to play in them and that. So please, when the weather's hot, you've got to be mindful of children and water. Another thing is animals. Animals are being dumped at a record rate. This past week, a house in Bradley Beach, New Jersey, the woman moved out. She left 38 cats in there to starve to death. And Buddy, I can't think of his last name. He's the officer for Monmouth County SPCA. He ended up going in and finding all the dead animals. If you know somebody moves out and you know they had animals, please go check to see if they've left animals there. And if you see animals there, or you call up the authorities and say, I think they might have left animals there, and they don't come and check, you make a lot of noise. Go to the newspapers and report it, because animals starving to death, it can take weeks for animals to starve to death. It's not a pleasant way to go. Another thing is animal shelters need help. So please consider donating food, clean old, instead of throwing old blankets away, wash them up, cut them into sections, and donate them for animals in different shelters and that, because shelters are really struggling to keep up with what's going on. And remember, your elderly, electric bills are high. We understand that, and it costs a lot of money to run air conditioning, but elderly people will very often think, I don't need the air conditioning. I used to sit out in 100 degrees when I was 20 years old. They're not 20 anymore. So please make sure your elderly are okay, that they're cool, that they, you know, they're safe in this kind of heat. Make sure they have a lot of water and fluids. And don't just call. You've got to face them and ask them questions to make sure that they are lucid, that they understand what you're saying to them. Because with heat, they can get very tired very quickly, and they'll go through the motions on the phone and say, yeah, I'm fine, everything's fine, okay, goodbye, and you don't know what's going on. And next thing you know, they've succumbed to heat. So please check your elderly. This is Crazy Butt News. Deal traffic stops and nabs a man named God. Evidently, God was stopped and in Deal, New Jersey. The guy's name is God J. Davis. He's 33 years old, Vesbury Park. And he was one of three men stopped during a motor vehicle stop. And all he had to do was actually tell them what his real name was. But he started lying. And the next thing you know, they found out that his name was God. And they arrested him for trying to get out of several outstanding bench warrants. They arrested him. So even God is not above the law. He gets arrested. I thought that was just too funny. With that, I want to thank everybody for listening in. Please send our links around. Let your friends know that we're here. We're here on every Tuesday live. And next week, we're going to have hoaxes on the internet. Internet hoaxes is going to be our topic. And the reason is I always get these things on the internet that says, don't pass this along. It's a virus. You'll lose everything. Or you'll get something about a missing person or something. And then when you go into one of these hoax sites, you find out that it's not true. It's a complete fabrication. So next week we're going to do a show on hoaxes. So if any of you have a pet peeve with hoaxes, please feel free to get a hold of me at asylumsgate.com and send me your pet peeve for a hoax, because they can drive you nuts on Facebook and all. You get one a day, and it says, "Oh, a friend told me that their computer crashed." And then you find out it's a five-year-old hoax that somebody, did, and they just changed a few of the sentences, and it gets old. And it's one of my pet peeves. So next week, we're going to be doing internet hoaxes, and what a pain in the can they are. And with that, I'm going to end the show. Thank you all for listening. Thank you to our guests tonight, Jim Pierson, Kathryn Leigh Scott, and Lara Parker. You can find them all. They all have, well, Jim doesn't have a site, but you can find him and get a hold of him through either of the ladies. And their books are on sale. Please thank our guests by buying their books. If you know somebody who likes to read, that's the way to thank our guests. Buy their books. These are beautiful books. I think you're all going to love them. And they're right up our alley. They're about, dark shadows. Thank you all. God bless you all, and good night.
Somewhere over the rainbow, birds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow.
Visiting me at my lair. Mo Banshee's Lair is broadcast live on Tuesday evenings at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Mountain, 7 p.m. Pacific, and in the UK, 3 a.m. Wednesday mornings on www.gameconradio.com. You can listen to our recent recordings on Podomatic/Mo Banshee. You can contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for listening. God bless you and yours, and have a very cool day.